We started with Raman spectroscopy in our last video with the basic principle that the scattered light is used to measure the vibrational energy modes of any sample which is under investigation. Secondly, for a vibrational mode to be measured, a sample must be Raman active, which occurs when the molecular polarizability changes during vibration. And of course, not all the vibrational modes can be detected using this technique. It extracts its information basically from the Raman scattering of the sample. Next, we will try to understand the scattering which is observed in this technique. Actually, the monochromator laser light with frequency nu naught, it is subjected upon a molecule wherein a molecule absorbs the energy of the radiation and it transforms into an oscillating dipole with a higher energy. When this happens, the oscillating dipole emits the light, which in this case is observed to possess the frequency same as that of the laser beam incident upon the molecule. That means the frequency of the scattered radiation is found to be the same as that of the incident radiation. Now, the light scattered, it carries the same frequency with that of the incident light. This actually happens when a molecule possessing an electron in a particular energy level with no Raman active modes, it absorbs a photon which is incident upon it and excites to the higher energy level. Now, this electron moves to a higher energy level, and just because this higher energy level is a temporary phase, so it comes back to its initial energy level. When the electron comes back to its initial energy level, it emits the light with the same frequency nu naught, which is as the same as that of an excitation source. Now, let's try to understand in some other words. Raman scattering, actually, it can be thought of as a two-photon process. The electrons have different vibrational levels that are actually defined by different energy levels which they reside in. The electron then falls back to its energy level in which it loses its energy. So, in the process of falling back to its energy level, lower energy level, it loses energy. Now, if the energy lost in this process is equal to the energy of incident photon, then the electron falls back to its initial level from which it had gone to the higher level. And in this process, it emits another photon. Now, since the energy which is lost is equal to the energy of the incident photon, so we say that the frequency of the incident photon is found to be just equal or same as that of the emitted photon, or let's say the scattered beam, the scattered light which we observe. And we get a spectrum like this in the Raman spectrum. Right. So, it is the process wherein the molecule absorbs the laser energy, gets excited to the higher energy state, which is the virtual state of that species. And when it comes back to its original level, energy level from which it had gone up, it emits that extra amount of energy. Right. And this emitted photon is actually the one which we measure. So, we say that the scattered beam of light or the scattered radiation which is observed in this process carries the same frequency as that of the incident laser. And we get a Raman spectrum like this. Now, this type of interaction is called as elastic Rayleigh scattering. This is called as Rayleigh scattering. Right. So, but some fraction of light have different frequency due to interaction between oscillation of light and the molecular vibration. And the phenomena that the light is scattered with frequency change, it is called as Raman scattering, which we will study in our upcoming slides. The scattering of light by the molecule causes the oscillating electromagnetic field of a photon to induce polarization of the molecular electron cloud. And it is only a very, very minute fraction of the molecules, perhaps one in, let's say, 10 million, that has lost or gained energy or that are Raman scattered. So here we gain some points. That means it is only a very small part of the scattered fraction which has gain or lost the energy. Otherwise, it carries the same frequency, same energy as that of the incident light. And also the scattering of light by the molecule, it causes an oscillating electromagnetic field of a photon to induce polarization of the molecular electron. That means that is how the polarization of the molecular electron cloud is subjected, just by the scattering of light. Okay, we move forward. So the first case was the Rayleigh scattering, in which the photon or the scattered light carries the same frequency as that of the incident light. Now in the second case, what happens? The Raman shift occurs because some fraction of light have differently frequency due to the exchange or the interaction between the oscillation of light and the molecular vibration. Let's see how it happens. Actually, the molecule, again, it is made incident upon a laser, monochromatic laser light that carries a frequency mu naught. And after some time, we observe that the frequency of the scattered light, it is actually lesser than that of the the incident light. So the photon with frequency mu naught is absorbed and energy it is transferred to the Raman active molecule. Now this Raman active molecules move to the higher energy state, fine, which is actually a temporary state of that species, and then it comes back to the lower energy level. Now, the fate where the electron lies finally gives us whether the frequency of the scattered light is lesser than the incident light or it is equal to the incident light as we observed in our previous slide. Now, let's try to understand this phenomena with the help of this figure. These are the various energy levels in which the electron is residing in one of the energy levels. So lowest one, in which our electron is present in the lowest energy level, and this is the second energy level, third, fourth, and so on and so forth. Now this dotted line represents the virtual state of the energy wherein the electron is moving. So the electron is subjected with the laser beam. Frequency mu naught is the frequency of the laser beam. After absorbing the energy from the laser beam, the electron moves to the higher energy state or the virtual state. So the electron has moved to the virtual state. After some time, what happens? It comes back to the lower energy level, which actually is not the same as from where it had started its journey. It is actually some higher energy state. So in this process, when it is coming back to the lower energy level, this energy gap is lesser than the previous one from which the electron had started its journey. So hence, the final frequency is actually lesser than the initial one. In other words, the energy of the scattered light observed here is lesser than that of the incident light, and this we get in the Raman spectrum as Stokes frequency or the Stokes, wherein you see that this mu naught represents the Rayleigh scattering which we had studied, in our previous slide, and the small peak lying to the left of the Rayleigh scattering is our Stokes frequency or the simply Stokes, wherein it is equal to mu naught minus mu t, right? So this is how we get a Stokes frequency or a Stoke. And when does this happen? When the frequency of the scattered light is found to be less than that of the incident light. Let's now learn about this third state, third kind of scattering that the oscillating molecule is giving us. A photon with a frequency mu naught is absorbed by the Raman active molecule. So we have a molecule over here, and a laser beam is made incident upon this molecule. The molecule absorbs the energy from this laser beam. It's one of the same thing that we had done in the learned in the previous slide also. And after absorbing the energy from this laser beam of light, it then jumps to the higher energy level, right, which is the excited vibrational state. Now this excess amount of energy is attained by the molecule, and when it is moving back to its lower energy level, this extra amount of energy is released by the molecule, or let's say the resulting energy of the scattered light. Let's see what it is now. Now this time it is observed that the resulting energy of the scattered light, it becomes greater than that of the incident light. Okay, so how does that happen? That basically happens when the electron from the higher energy level, it jumps back to the lower energy level. The frequency of the scattered light this time is observed to be higher than that of the incident light. Now such case arises when the electron, it returns back to the energy level which is much lower than that of where it had started from. So it is basically the question of what energy level is the electron starting its journey, and to what energy level is it coming back. With respect to the initial and the final energy levels, the frequency, or let's say the energy of the scattered beam of light is changing. It can be equal to that of the incident light, wherein the electron returns back to the same energy level. It is lesser when the electron returns to an energy level higher than from where it had started its journey. And on the other hand, the frequency or the energy is greater than that of the initial state, wherein the electron moves to a much lower energy level from where it had started its journey. Now this type of observation is observed on this spectrum in the form of this anti-Stokes frequency, or simply anti-Stokes. So this is the overall Raman spectrum that we usually get. The central one, it is the Rayleigh scattering, or it represents the Rayleigh scattering, and as you can see that the height of Rayleigh scattering is much much more as compared to the Stokes and anti-Stokes frequency. To the left of Rayleigh scattering lies the Stokes frequency or the Stokes, and to the right of Rayleigh scattering lies the anti-Stokes or the anti-Stokes frequency. And just remember one thing, the frequency of the scattered light is lesser than that of the incident light in case of Stokes, whereas it is greater than that of the incident light in case of anti-Stokes. We rarely use the anti-Stokes Raman light as it is less intense than the Stokes. However, it does represent equivalent vibrational information of the entire molecule. So we can say that the change in energy depends actually on the frequency of the vibration of the molecule. And if it is a very fast or a high frequency molecule, that means lighter atoms are held together with strong bonds, then the energy change is majorly significant. But if on the other hand, if it is a very slow or a low frequency heavier atoms, remember heavier atoms, then definitely it will be moving or vibrating with a lower frequency. Then the heavier atoms, they held together with weak bonds. The energy change in that case is small,